How the Other Half Lives by Jacob Riis. Long ago, it was said that that one half of the world does not know how the other half lives. That was true then. It did not know because it did not care. The half that was on top cared little for the struggles and less for the fate of those who were underneath, so long as it was able to hold them there and keep its own seat. Today, 3/4 of New York's people live in the tenements, and the 19th century drift of the population to the cities is sending ever-increasing multitudes to crowd them. The 15,000 tenant houses that were the despair of the sanitarian in the past generation have swelled into 37,000, and more than 1,200,000 persons call them home. We know now that there is no way out, that the system that was the evil offspring of public neglect and private greed has come to stay, a storm center forever of our civilization. Nothing is left but to make the best of a bad bargain. The situation was summed up by the Society for the Improvement of the Condition of the Poor in these words: crazy old buildings, crowded rear tenements and filthy yards, dark, damp basements, leaking garrets, shops, outhouses, and stables converted into dwellings, though scarcely fit to shelter brutes, are habitations of thousands of our fellow beings in this wealthy Christian city. Today, what is a tenement? The law defines it as a house occupied by three or more families, living independently and doing their cooking on the premises, or by more than two families on a floor, so living and cooking and having have a common right in the halls, stairways, yards, etc. That is the legal meaning, and includes flats and apartment houses, with which we have nothing to do. In its narrower sense, the typical tenement was thus described when last arraigned before the bar of public justice. It is generally a brick building from 4 to 6 stories high on the street, frequently with a store on the first floor which, when used for the sale of liquor, has a side opening for the benefit of the inmates and to evade the Sunday law. Four families occupy each floor, and a set of rooms consists of one or two dark closets used as bedrooms, with the living room 12 feet by 10. The staircase is too often a dark well in the center of the house, and no direct through ventilation is possible, each family being separated from the others by partitions. Frequently, the rear of the lot is occupied by another building of 3 stories high with 2 families on a floor. The tenements today are New York, harboring 3/4 of its population. When another generation shall have doubled the census of our city, and to that vast army of workers held captive by poverty, the very name of home shall be as bitter mockery. What will the harvest be? New York's wage earners have no other place to live. More is the pity. They are truly poor for having no better homes, waxing poorer in purse as the exorbitant rents to which they are tied, as ever was serf to soil, keep rising. The wonder is that they are not all corrupted, and speedily, by their surroundings. Dirt and desolation reign in the wide hallway, and danger lurks on the stairs. Rough pine boards fence off the roomy fireplaces, where coal is brought by the pail at the rate of $12 a ton. These have no place. The arched gateway leads no longer to a shady bower on the banks of the rushing stream, inviting to daydreams with its gentle repose, but to a dark and nameless alley, shut in by high brick walls, cheerless as the lives of those they shelter. The wolf knocks loudly at the gate, and the troubled dreams that come to this alley, echoes of the day's cares. A horde of dirty children play about the dripping hydrant, the only thing in the alley that thinks enough of its chance to make the most of it. It is the best it can do. These are the children of the tenements, the growing generation of the slums. This, their home. From the great highway overhead, along which throbs the lifetide of two great cities, one might drop a pebble into half a dozen such alleys. What sort of an answer, think you, would come from these tenements to the question, is life worth living, were they heard at all in the discussion? It may be that this, cut from the last report, but one of the Association for the Improvement of the Condition of the Poor, a long name for a weary task, has a suggestion of it. In the depth of winter, the attention of the association was called to a Protestant family living in a garret in a miserable tenement in Cherry Street. The family's condition was most deplorable. The man, his wife, and 3 small children shivering in one room through the roof of which the pitiless winds of winter whistled. The room was almost barren of furniture. The parents slept on the floor, the elder children in boxes, and the baby was swung in an old shawl attached to the rafters by cords by way of a hammock. The father, a seaman, had been obliged to give up that calling because he was in consumption and was unable to provide either bread or fire for his little ones. With the first hot nights in June, police dispatches that record the killing of men and women by rolling off roofs and windowsills while asleep announced that the time of greatest suffering among the poor is at hand. It is in hot weather, when life indoors is well nigh unbearable with cooking, sleeping, and working, all crowded into the small rooms together, that the tenement expands, reckless of all restraint. Then a strange and picturesque life moves upon the flat roofs. In the day and early evening, mothers air their babies there, the boys fly their kites from the housetops, undismayed by police regulations, and the young men and girls court and pass the growler. In the stifling July nights, when the big barracks are like fiery furnaces, their very walls giving out absorbed heat, men and women lie in restless, sweltering rows, panting for air and sleep. Then every truck in the street, every crowded fire escape, becomes a bedroom, infinitely preferable to any the house affords. A cooling shower on such a night is hailed as a heaven-sent blessing in 100,000 homes. Life in the tenements in July and August spells death to an army of little ones whom the doctor's skill is powerless to save. When the white badge of mourning flutters from every second door, sleepless mothers walk the streets in the gray of the early dawn, trying to steer a cooling breeze to fan the brow of the sick baby. There is no sadder sight than this patient devotion striving against fearfully hopeless odds. The measles, ordinarily a harmless disease, furnishes a familiar example. Tread it ever so lightly on the avenues. In the tenements it kills right and left. There were houses in which as many as 8 little children had died in 5 months. A message came one day last spring summoning me to a Mott Street tenement in which lay a child dying from some unknown disease. With the charity doctor, I found the patient on the top floor, stretched upon 2 chairs in a dreadfully stifling room. She was gasping in the agony of periodontitis that had already written its death sentence on her wan and pinched face. The whole family, father, mother, and 4 ragged children, sat around looking on with the stony resignation of helpless despair that had long since given up the fight against fate as useless. A glance around the wretched room left no doubt as to the cause of the child's condition. Improper nutrition, said the doctor, which translated to suit the place meant starvation. Every once in a while, a case of downright starvation gets into the newspaper and makes a sensation. But this is the exception. Were the whole truth known, it would come home to the community with a shock that would rouse it to a more serious effort than this spasmodic undoing of its purse strings. I am satisfied from my own observation that hundreds of men, women, and children are every day slowly starving to death in the tenements with my medical friend's complaint of improper nourishment. In 20 years, what has been done in New York to solve the tenement house problem? The law has done what it could. Public sentiment has done something also, but very far from enough. The landlord has done his share. Business, in a wider sense, has done more than all other agencies together to wipe out the worst tenements. Though the problem stands yet unsolved, more perplexing than ever, though the bright spots in the dreary picture be too often bright only by comparison, and many of the expedients hit upon for relief's sad makeshifts, we can dimly discern behind it all that good is somehow working out of even this slough of despond, the while it is deepening and widening in our sight, and in his good season, if we labor on with courage and patience, will bear fruit 60 and 100-fold.